Neuse River used to be a very safe place. When my kids were in Boy Scouts, we used to take trips down the river. We used to get in the river and swim and just float down the river. We camped on the river. We fished on the river. We used the river water to clean our pots and pans. But this is before we knew.
In 1954, Duke Energy built a coal-fired plant here on the Neuse River and started burning coal and generated coal ash.
The trains would come in, and you'd hear all this blam, 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 and that's where they were unloading the coal into underground bins. Then they would grind it up, and then they would burn it. I first became aware of the actual coal ash issue when I was sent a letter from Duke, and they told us that they wanted to test our well. We got the results back, and it was just a great big stack of papers with a lot of words that I didn't understand. And shortly after that, we got a letter and told us not to drink the water from the well.
The health department called and said, do not use your water. Do not drink your water. Because I'd been drinking that water for years, for over 12 years. We had a lot of tornadoes. We've had a lot of heavy rains. We've had flash floods in this area. Up until a year and a half ago, you know, I was not concerned about the flooding because I didn't know anything about coal ash. When it's raining, you wonder how far the groundwater with coal ash on it is going to travel.
In 1999, when we had Hurricane Floyd with all of the flooding, we thought, oh boy, this is the 100-year flood. There's no way it can happen again while I'm living on this earth. Little did we know that in less than 20 years, it was back again.
When Matthew came, October the 8th, it resulted in flooding and inundating the coal ash ponds. Coal ash was deposited, and you could see a film almost 2 inch thick of coal ash that had came up from the ponds and floated down the Neuse River.
When I came back to the house after I was able to get back in, everything was a mess. There, of course, there's an actual water line on the side of the wall. Things had been floated from room to room, papers, and I mean, everything was just soaked. And it was devastating. Everything that we had worked for all those years, it was destroyed. I'm not really sure that there's anything that can be done to make my well safe. I know that Duke Energy is talking about having us hooked onto the community water system, but the community water system water is taken from the Neuse River.
The rains and the water continue, and the ash is still in the ponds. Just waiting for the day that we can hope it'll be cleaned, a very clean environment again.
My grandchildren were in and out of my house. You know, I mean, they lived locally. And I think about how many glasses of tea did they drink? How much water did they have? You know, how many times did they have a bath in that water? And what's it going to do to them? Nobody should have to live through this. Nobody should be put in this position. It has been a great strain emotionally, financially, and it's never going to end. That's my thing. It's just never going to end.
in this neighborhood, there are a lot of changes going on. People that can afford it, it seems like they're pushing out the people that can't afford to stay in this neighborhood. It's a lot of frustration, especially when you're living in poverty. It's a lot of frustration because you don't have a lot of options. I know a lot of people that do not have electricity.
So many times we have people calling, my electric bill, I couldn't pay it, and we are sitting in the dark with the kids. These parents will come here in tears. I don't even know what to do, because electricity is not only about lighting, but it's also about cooking.
People don't think that stuff exists, but it does. It does happen. I've seen people use candlelight, you know, by night, and just use the daylight by day because they can't afford their electricity bill. A lot of them, this community is an old community. So a lot of the houses don't have the insulation that is needed. So when these individuals come in for help, sometimes their bills are like $300-$400. I've even seen it as high as $600.
It's frustrating for me being a renter because, one, you can call your landlord, you can tell your landlord, they might come out and do something about it. 9 times out of 10, they not. Okay, so you're still burning this money, still going out your window somewhere. They're not going to come out and assess the situation.
We have, quote, central air and heat. But if it gets too cold outside, we have no heat. It's blowing. It's constantly on, and it's blowing cool air. Like, for me, what I have to do, I have to get kerosene. But you imagine how much you're spending a day buying kerosene to warm up your house when you have central heat that's not warming up your house, but they still add that to part of your bill.
You know, we dressed to go to bed, had extra blankets, got up in the morning. Late at night, I would cut the kerosene down as low as possible so it wouldn't be freezing cold in here, but I wouldn't burn up a lot of stuff. Of the kerosene fuel. So in the morning time, I would turn it up so it would warm up enough for them to get up, and I would boil water, you know, so they would have warm water to wash out with. And that's how we did it.
Not having a livable wage job. I have a job, but not having a livable wage job. And you have more than one child, and you're sitting here and you're looking at your money, and you're doing your budget, and you're trying to figure out, and every month at the end of your budget, you still come out negative, this, that, and the other. But put yourself in that place. How would you feel going with all this that's going on, going to someone and asking for help?
Someone comes to us and say, I don't have light in my house. For me, I don't look at just the lights. I look at it, that's how they provide food. That's how they can see each other. That's just like what gives them hope. When you have light in your house, it shows that you have life. And if that is gone, even your dreams are shut off.
Because Durham is constantly, this part of the community is constantly on the news. It's feared, it's shunned, and it tends not to get this support of what it needs to cause the people to be productive in their daily lives. If your rent is $350, $400, $500, and your light bill is $400, it just doesn't add up. It's very difficult. You want me to decide between my living and my lights. I can live without lights, but I can't live without a home.
There's no real win-win situation when people are forced out of their homes because they can no longer afford the mortgage or no longer can afford the rent. It's really sad. I don't know how much longer I'm gonna be here. I can't afford it.
Our service area is in one of the most economically distressed regions of our state and the country, actually. The electricity costs for our members is proportionally high in relationship to their overall budget. It takes up a good portion of it, and it comes every month.
You got it all the way up? There we go. Up. 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 We are here at Allen Grove Baptist Church. We're doing some weatherization, concentrating on making this church facility energy efficient, i.e. doing infiltration, adding insulation, things of that nature. There are a lot of things that need to happen here because we're dealing with a church that is 121 years old. They had high energy usage. They were spending about $600 to $700 a month on propane usage. So we're gonna knock off about $400 to $500 just replacing those units.
We have tried for years to try to come up with a way to do upgrades at our members' homes that can help them reduce their electricity costs. In the past, the member would have to have a financial obligation to take on a loan, one that they really can't afford to take on. With Upgrade to Save, the difference is that the utility is going to take on the front end costs and remove the burden of them having to take out a loan. And at the end of it, all the member has to do is remain obligated to pay for those costs over time as a portion of their electric utility bill.
I was so frustrated that I was about to move. I wanted to move because the air conditioner broke down, insulation was hanging down from the house, some of the ductwork needed work on it. But one of the first things they did when they came up was kind of shocking to me. They came up and went in my attic and they insulated my attic. Even the door to my attic, they insulated that. The vents here, they insulated that. Even my hot water heater insulated that. And like I said, they made sure that you wouldn't have any air escaping that wasn't being used. I've gotten light bills in. My light bills have been at least $100 or $200 cheaper than it was last year this time, and I'm really pleased with the system. When you're saving energy, you're saving the environment. I'm a kind of environmental type person, so I love country life. Yeah, I love the fresh air and stuff like that. That's just me. Yeah.
We have addressed the myth that high tech or technologically advanced things that are happening in our society today are not suitable for low wealth communities, and we're working hard to prove that as a myth only. We are a highly technical organization, and we're using technology to drive down costs. If we can do whatever we need to do to reduce the demand for electricity, it impacts our wholesale power costs. And guess what? It impacts every member that we serve because we're reducing our wholesale power costs, which is spread across the entire system. What it really boils down to for us is that the health of the community equates to the health of the utility.